I took an interesting approach. It was a page out of the Waze playbook, which is at Waze, we opened up all over the world very quickly instead of going market by market the way some have done. That's what Uber did. And we just waited to see where there was the most interest. And then we would come in and fan those flames. And what we found is that there was a lot of pent up demand. So we're already operating in 33 states and they're not the states we would have imagined. Right. So Georgia is really hot for us. Ohio is hot. Wouldn't have predicted that. So
yeah,
we just kind of open. We see how people are using it. We're watching, we're learning, we're listening, and we're trying to be really responsive to everybody.
If you're enjoying Builtcast, enjoy lunch on us. Visit bangerdinc.com and click webinars and classes to sign up for an Acumatica Lunch and Learn, where you'll take a look at how next generation construction ERP can transform the way you do business. Sign up, chow down, and we look forward to seeing you there. Hey everybody, it's Reed
and Kurt,
and you're listening to Builtcast, brought to you by BangerDinc. Our guest today is Di-Ann Eisnor, co-founder and CEO of Core, a revolutionary new construction labor marketplace. We spoke with Di-Ann about how her experience leading the team at Waze and being a serial entrepreneur ultimately led her to the construction industry. With Core, Di-Ann and her team have created a singular source for construction companies and tradespeople to connect on projects and jobs that are relevant and hopefully builds many careers that build the world. Well, Di-Ann, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
So tell me a little bit about how you got your start in technology, you know, in general. Is this something you always knew that you wanted to do, or did you get involved in it later on, or, you know, how did you get started?
I believe that I've always been interested in creative things or cutting edge tools. And I don't know that I really considered it only about technology. At earlier stages in my life, it was probably more in the art world. But I do remember having access to a very early computer in third grade and teaching the other kids programming. So there was an early love, but I would say I got back into it in the early 90s from the art world. And so there was like the beginning of a fusion artist trying to figure out what to do with this new technology and internet coming. And that's when I got really excited about it. And that's what I've been doing ever since.
So what are some of the things, like, what, how did you land on the idea of Core and the app and getting people connected with, you know, the labor force?
Well, I come from a family of truck drivers and tradesmen, right? So this is somehow in my blood, even though I'm in Silicon Valley now. And, you know, over the years, I think one of the more pivotal moments was at Waze. I started something called the Connected Citizens Program. And this was taking our data, not personally identifiable data, but information about what was happening on the roads, and getting it into traffic operation centers. And we were in traffic operation centers in 1,500 cities, actually, with a small tool set that allowed those cities to use the data to reduce congestion, improve emergency response times, and it was really working. And so that's the first time I realized, wow, you can use software to make a big impact in the real world, in the physical space. So then I went off to WeWork, was more exposed to construction and development and that whole process. And so, of course, as soon as you confront it, you think, oh, wow, well, this is a problem and that's a problem. And what do we do? So I knew when we left WeWork that I wanted to start a company in the construction space. I wanted to serve my roots better. And after talking to, you know, maybe 100 workers and a dozen general contractors, it was clear that there was a big need in the labor space. And so we just went all in and we just launched our product September of 2020. So wow. It's early days for us. We're not at the scale stage. You know, I took Waze from 10,000 people to 150 million. So we definitely have a way to go.
Yeah.
But it's, I can't imagine wanting to spend my time doing anything else. It's so exciting to be working in this space.
So tell me a little bit about, like, what problem did you see? And then what, you know, how did you go about solving it?
So the obvious problem that we saw first is that there's a labor shortage. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's easy to say, well, people haven't been going to trade schools for the last few decades. It's easy to say, you know, there are a lot of reasons for this. And in some ways, it's a labor shortage. In some ways, the learning for us is that it's an opportunity shortage. There are, in this industry, the folks in the field, the real craftsmen, they tend to have smaller social networks than what we would have in Silicon Valley, right? So if you're only able to get referrals from a small group of people, then your options are going to be more limited. So our approach to this was, okay, technology is really great at reducing friction. Let's just focus on the matchmaking side, on the matching algorithm. Let's just make sure that anyone who comes in is able to be matched well with the job opportunities that are there.
Yeah. I mean, overall, tell us just how it works. I mean, how is it making the connection?
So from the perspective of the GC, say the employer and the worker, you download one app, Cruise by Core, try to make it very, very simple. Everybody that comes into the system, no matter which side of the marketplace you're on, you have to give us the same information. So we want to be really transparent, you know, what's your name, what's your trade, how long have you been in the business, collect some really basic information. And then there's an opportunity to add your, if you're the worker, to add your skills, to add a photo of yourself. And a lot of people don't like this because they think they might be judged on the photo, but it's actually a little hack to make it feel like there's a more in-person connection. So we found that that's really important. And then referrals. Who are the people who can vouch for your skills? So we include all of that right there. So there's a little bit of more context for the hire. And then the hire just comes in and they press the link that says hire. and they put in what they're looking for. And immediately it goes out to our entire system. The matching algorithm takes hold. We start to make sure that, okay, from the job description here and the worker skills on this side, what are the keywords that need to be matched? Is it the right geography? Is it the right set of skills? And then before we even say anything to the hirer, all of the people in our system will get a notification immediately saying, hey, there's something. Do you want to apply to this job? And so for those who for whom it's relevant, they'll automatically apply with one click. And you'll be in the inside the app for the hirer to review. And then importantly, communication in this industry is so hard. It's like you can call someone 25 times, they won't get back to you. Maybe you'll try texting, they like that better. Whatever it is, the hirer can actually reach out and text or call all of the workers as they're vetting them, plus see their entire profile with a little QR code so that they can, you know, make sure it's the same person who ends up on site.
Yeah. So what is that like? I mean, what are folks looking for when, you know, I mean, when, if I'm a prospective employer in the construction space, I mean, what are some of their must haves?
So for the employer, it's interesting. Soft skills are so important to every hire we've talked to, you know, whether it's being prompt or being collaborative or being a good team player or just showing up. You know, that's something that I think a lot of people underestimate when they're putting, you know, when they're putting themselves out there. The other thing that I see people didn't used to do, and now on our service, they're doing it more and more, is talk about the scope of the project. So were you doing a $300,000 project or a $50 million project? And particularly the large commercial folks, they want to know what is the scope of the work that you've done before. And so sometimes a worker won't know, but often they will, or they can at least say, oh, it was a hospital or it was a, you know, a small home or so they can say those things. And oftentimes, once you ask them the question, they actually do know.
Yeah. It sounds like your app, you know, really solves some bigger problems. Like if, you know, I'm a contractor and I'm looking to expand to a different state or, you know, I'm in a new market that, you know, I can start bidding outside of, you know, maybe the region that I'm used to or accustomed to.
Actually, that's something that we've seen quite a bit. We have one contractor that's hiring in four states right now.
Yeah.
And they always prefer local crews. And depending on where you are, there's also incentives for the developer or the GC to hire locally.
Yeah.
And so one of the benefits that they see is we can bring workers, but we can also bring crews. People can come with their whole crew. And that's been a really good way to jumpstart this whole process. So that does happen. And then there's also, you know, we had the first person to post a job in Maryland just recently. And, you know, I was a little nervous. Oh, I don't know what it's going to be like. Yeah. How many people did we have in Maryland? And so he posted, and then within the next day, he started getting applicants, and he ended up getting too many. He got 100 applicants. Wow. So we helped him narrow that down. And because the matching algorithm actually, it gives each worker a score. So we sort them by the highest score. So he just went down and he ended up hiring 6 people within a week. And he said that this is his pipeline for the year for the things that he needs now. So that stories like that keep coming in, and that feels great.
What's the most surprising thing that's come from this journey you're on?
There have been a lot of surprises. I would say many of the surprises come from the conversations with the GCs on the GC side. Mm-hmm. For them, this is something interesting. It's not just about the labor shortage for them. It's about managing the labor. And so they would start saying to us from very early on, we don't want you just to match with new workers. We want to put our existing workers in your system, and we want to build crews with our existing workers and the new workers. Mm. So we started doing that. But I think that was one of the big surprises, is that they would see what we built and say, oh no, we want to use it like this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see how that could actually be really beneficial. You know, kind of the ability to sort of, I don't know, rank performance or something like that in terms of, hey, I'm used to this, you know, these 6 folks or these 12 folks, like they've done an outstanding job for me in the past, and I want to make sure that they're my first, you know, first kind of call on my next gig. So,
and that's a great point too that you just bring up. Yeah. Is, you know, have you done work in the past, but also, we do have ratings and rankings inside of the app as yeah. well to really help build up that credibility. Because one thing is the hiring, another is the managing, but there's also in the middle this vetting process. How do I know that this is even a qualified person? It's pretty tricky. So whatever signals we can get in there that help the hirer make a better decision, whether it's the referrals, the skills, the rating, that's all part of the picture. So hopefully we're going to get to a point where we'll only give you 10 candidates and they're all the perfect ones you would
right. want to hire. So what about on like the employee side? Like, is there an opportunity, you know, for them to rate the companies that are hiring? I mean, is that part of
you the can program? Their ratings go both ways.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Cool. Absolutely. I mean, because think about it from the worker perspective, right? This worker centricity is kind of on the rise again after a few decades of really not being. And I think part of it is, you know we have high turnover in the industry. Well, okay, let's treat our people better. Let's align the incentives. Let's think about those things. Let's give access to training and career development. And, you know, one of the important things for people is to have transparency about what company you're going to work for. And by the way, this is a US issue, but it's also a global issue. So all over the world, there's 180 million construction workers that could benefit from having better understanding of, is this person going to be around? What's their rating? How did they treat people? And so, sure. Yeah, I think that's a big one.
Is there something, you know, a thought you would, you know, challenge those folks that are using your app, like think about something, you know, is there something you would challenge them with and to inspire maybe a thought or a new direction or anything like that?
For the hirer, I would say, you know, it really depends on the size, but say for the big mm-hmm. guys, yeah. it's harder for them to try new ways to hire, right? It's there's a lot of using traditional recruiters. There's, you know, going through HR or going through your general superintendents. And those two sides of the house don't always communicate very well. So the same people that are hiring your project managers are not the same people that are hiring your trades.
Right.
And I would challenge people, I guess, to think, how can you have one system that you can achieve all of those goals so that people are treated more equally
yeah.
across the organization?
So same kind of question if I'm in a trade. You know, tell me about what would you be thinking about if you're a tradesperson and, you know, you want to, this is your career, you want to be great in it.
Be specific, you know, give as much detail about the projects you've worked on. If you have jumped around a lot and there's a good reason for it, say why. Because the number one thing that's going to stand out to a hirer is, oh, wow, you had three jobs in the last 3 years, right? So if you can address that up front and it's you have a good reason, you know,
yeah.
Oh, I had a new opportunity. Great. Then say that up front. So yeah, specific on your skills. If you have gaps, talk about why. Give your referrals, right? Bring in as many people who can vouch for your skills as possible. Is it your previous foreman? Is it your super? Is it your brother-in-law who owned the company? Whatever it is, try to add those pieces of the puzzle. And, you know, it's not just our system, but, you know, even if you want to make a resume, try to add those things. And then obviously our system is geared to walk you through that process.
That's awesome. Like what's your end goal? I mean, do you want to be global? Do you want to be in every country? I mean, where do you see CORE going?
So I always think of things in terms of this is the Silicon Valley in me, right? Like how big of an impact can you make?
Yeah.
And so I really think about two things. I think about how to shift a culture. And by shift, I don't mean single-handedly, but I mean opening up ideas for our workers to be better represented around the world, right? That's 180 million people that suffer from a lot of the same issues everywhere. So I definitely want to be global, but I also want to look at not just the hiring side, but I have a notion of an entire labor operating system, right? Like how do you get people on the job, performing at their peak, being able to get feedback so that they understand how they can improve, and that they get the credit that they deserve. Because often, even inside of the company, there's one or two people who know what skills any individual has. And for the rest, you know, when HR or your super is, you know, deciding who gets raises, who gets bonuses, who gets promoted, there's not a lot of data to go on.
Yeah.
And so I really feel like if you look at this as a big platform, as opposed to just a single point solution, that we can really make a dent in putting the worker at the center of all of this, which is great for the GCs, yeah. Right? Because, I mean, just look at rework. I think something like 9% of all construction costs are due to rework.
Yeah.
So imagine that the GCs could add another 10% to their bottom line.
So you've led growth at other companies. I mean, what are some key elements? Like, do you think like a longer hiring process is better than a shorter process? Or like, do you just, you know, do you do, like you said, think like an algorithm and apply the most logical, you know, logical method and questions and things like that to the process?
So I always think in terms of tools, even more so than technologies, right? If an HR person had this tool, how could it save them time or money? If a superintendent had this tool, how could it save them time or money? If a worker had this tool, what would be the benefit? And so I really try to take technologies and turn them into tools. And I would say that one of the tools I'm pretty excited about is figuring out, well, in our case, we built a web crawler, for example, that helps bring in new jobs. So it's a tool for us. And then we'll have to go contact those companies and say, okay, here we've got this many applicants that would fit your roles. And so we kind of, you know, we do that. We have built another tool that's like a chatbot that really helps make some of the conversations between people in the early stages much easier.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've done a lot of that. And you know, those are not exactly growth hacks, but it's using tools, helping technology become a tool to make things go faster. Obviously, we have a bunch of tools that we use on social media that are really helpful, excuse me, for bringing in new workers. So yeah, wherever we can, we're throwing in those bits for sure.
You've been around Silicon Valley for a long time. I mean, what's the best advice you've ever gotten?
Wow, I've had a lot of good advice. I guess I'll be repetitive and say, listen to your users, spend time in the field. That's, you know, when I go back again, it's like one thing to have an idea. It's another thing to have a scalable product that people love. And the make or break is how many conversations you have in the field, how well you can listen. And so I would say that's probably the best advice that I would both give and have gotten. And actually, I got that advice when I was at Google, because, you know, Google is very, very good at scale. We were extremely scrappy when we were starting Waze. And yeah, to get to that scale level, there's nothing quite like just spending time with your users.
That was Di-Ann Eisnor. For more information on Di-Ann and Core, visit bycore.com. That's bycore.com. If you're enjoying Builtcast, enjoy lunch on us. Visit bangerdink.com and click webinars and classes to sign up for an Acumatica Lunch and Learn, where you'll take a look at how next generation construction ERP can transform the way you do business. Sign up, chow down, and we look forward to seeing you there. Thanks for joining us. And if you like this episode, don't be shy. Share it with your friends and connections on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, and more. Builtcast is a production of Bangard Inc. Our producer is Kylie Jax. Our publisher is Luke Englert. Your hosts are Kurt and Reed Bangert. And our editor is Brandon Roden. For more info on Builtcast, head over to builtcast.com and our YouTube page at youtube.com/Bangard Inc. And don't forget, make it a great one.